in a previous meeting was the alternative use of truck routes. As to, I know that the only one that we currently have is Stewart Road. Commissioner Ramirez brought this concern as to what can we use as far as alternative routes goes. It's within your packet, the different maps that we currently, that we have here within the city of San Juan. The first map is pretty much the whole aerial of the whole city. And then as the pages go over, it's assuming of the particular city. Now, we have the, on the east over here, I don't know if you guys wanna like get up and talk about that. What would you recommend as far as an alternative truck route? It's almost very limited what we have, but it's here for discussion.
First of all, thank you so much, Mr. Garza, for being here. Appreciate it. I guess the first question, I know the main route that we have for the trucks is Stewart Road. How long, Mr. Garza, have the trucks been going down that road, coming from southbound, going north towards?
That's a good question. That I don't know, but I know that.
More or less.
It's
been a couple.
Been a while.
A while?
Excuse me,
Mayor.
Can you introduce?
My name is. I already did, sir, Mr.
Yeah, where is he from?
TxDOT, yeah.
Yeah, it's been a long time. And then the RMA, the Hidalgo County RMA, has designated Stewart Road 2557 as an overweight corridor,
right?
Which they collect funds for overweight trucks to use this corridor. So that is a designated truck route for the RMA. Sure. Yes, 2557 is a state highway, that's correct.
And so you guys maintain that road?
We maintain
it. It belongs to you completely, 110%.
Yes, that is correct.
Okay. Me?
Go ahead, sir.
Mr. Garza, do you know, do you have any ideas as to the number of accidents that have occurred on Stewart Road?
No, I do not.
None at all?
None, I don't know.
Okay.
Get that information for you if you would, you know, I would have to go back and run a report, but we can get that information to you. If you'd
right,
like.
Well, that's what I was looking for, because okay. I did request that from our chief, Gonzalez, and I believe, that's what I'm trying to look.
Yeah, he sent it over to you, Commissioner, and I have a copy of that.
Okay.
In 2016, there were 14, 17, 13, and in 2018, there were 8.
Okay, can you repeat that, sir?
Yes, 2016, there were a total of 14 accidents.
Okay.
It doesn't say, though, what kind of accident it was.
That was my next question. Were they minor, major?
It is.
Okay,
state.
So after, you said 2016, 14, what was the next one?
17 was 13.
17, 13, okay.
In 2018, there were a total of 8.
Okay.
I know that that's when they implemented some of those traffic lights there on Moore. there's a traffic light.
On Stewart also.
And more in Stewart, yeah.
On Stewart and Ridge, Stewart
yes.
And Ridge.
But also we need to compare into Cesar Chavez, how many accidents, because I know that that's a big congestion there, and there's a big traffic, you know, there's been some death in I think so it's on Ridge Road and Cesar Chavez.
Yes.
And that one doesn't have traffic lights, so, you know, just for us to compare, you know, if that's an alternative for a truck route or not, you know, but we need to compare also accidents in both.
So the purpose of these roads on the packet, Mr. Hona, can you explain a little bit as far as on that?
Yes, if you look at the first page, Mr. Escobar included the, based on the ordinance 2002-2012, those are the designated routes for trucks and commercial vehicles. All of these roads are highlighted accordingly, such as Alameda Street, there's a piece of Alameda, Cesar Chavez Road, FM 495, 1425, and so on and so forth. As far as the usage currently on heavy truck use, we haven't seen much of this, with the exception of Stewart Road. Now, there's minor trucking going in from possibly maybe what is it, San Antonio South?
Sometimes from business to Nebraska.
Right. Right, they can use that. Now, it's minimal use of heavy truck use in that area. Usually, I guess it's understood that heavy truck is through a Stewart Road versus any other one within the city.
You mentioned what, sir, again? Up-down Nebraska?
Right.
So that belongs to the state. It's a state road as well, right?
Okay.
Just that portion, because south of Old 83 belongs to the city. Am I correct?
Yes.
Okay.
So they come down Stewart Road, turn on Old 83, and then they can go up up to the expressway, the other direction they're going. But if they come all the way down to Stewart Road and into the Furnish Road, they could turn around on Cesar Chavez and get on top of the freeway.
Mr. Garza, with your expertise, sir, I know you've been working for TxDOT for many years. As far as the construction of a road for trucks like that, can you explain a little bit what's the thickness of the and the layers of the?
Well, there's what they do is they get the percent trucks, mm-hmm. How many trucks are running on that road, and then we have this program that determines our pavement structures. Some with heavy trucks like this, we usually have some pretty stout sections. Looking at anywhere from 12 inches of flex base, for sure 12 inches of subgrade. But your pavement itself, you're looking at anywhere from 3 to 4.5 inches, depending on the amount of trucks that are going through there. So you're looking at a pretty stout section.
Do you have any idea as to whether or not we have hazardous chemical commercial vehicles traveling through there?
That I don't know.
You don't know either.
I don't know if you know, Eddie. No, I can try to find out.
I think the concern is that we do have two campuses on that road, on Stewart Road. We have Austin Middle School and we have Sorensen Elementary.
Yes.
I know we are looking at the streets and how much weight they can and what the investment is going to be, but my concern is the students that attend those campuses and the parents that drop off and pick up students at that campus. That's where I'm getting the concerns from. So that's the reason that I was initiating this workshop, so that we can see what alternatives we have. We did meet in the summer, Mr. Arjona, Mr. Cervantes, myself, and Commissioner Guajardo with staff at TxDOT. I know you weren't part of that meeting, to discuss this issue. And so basically that's what we wanted to know. What alternatives do we have, if any, so that we can reroute them?
Okay, rerouting truck traffic, the problem right now is, mm-hmm. you would have to work with a Hidalgo County RMA, because this 2557 is already designated as an overweight corridor.
Uh-huh.
So any vehicles that are going north, they pay a fee to use these roads to the RMA. So you can't just restrict traffic to an overweight corridor, right? So the first step you would have to do is initiate conversations with the RMA. The second thing is you would have to have an alternate route for them, right? So since Stewart Road is a state roadway, you would have to be able to send them to another state roadway, right? So if you're sending them to another state roadway, the city of San Juan doesn't have another state roadway.
Right.
Right.
That's
so the only option you have is to send them to Alamo or to FAR.
Mm-hmm.
Now, what you would have to do before that would even be considered is you would have to have those conversations with Alamo or FAR and tell them all the trucks that were going through the city of San Juan, I want to send them to the city of Alamo, right? And then you would have to have that conversation because maybe they don't want the trucks, right? So that would be something that you guys would have to discuss and work out with either one of the cities. Then once you guys get that figured out, and if one of the cities is open to the idea, then you guys would have to submit that information to our district engineer saying that we're going to restrict truck traffic through 2557, and then you would have to submit where a drawing on where you're planning to send traffic through, and then send it to us, and then we review that, send it to our division up in Austin before we, and then they'll review it and give it a blessing or whatever, then it comes down, then you pass an ordinance restricting traffic. The biggest obstacle I think you have is that this is an overweight corridor already designated. So it'd be very difficult to restrict traffic that you already
have. Let me ask you this, Mr. Garza. Now, can Austin deny yes or deny the request?
I don't think that would be the issue. I think your biggest issue right now would be getting this off of the overweight corridor with the RMA. So, like, right now you wouldn't be able to, we wouldn't approve you all being able to restrict traffic because it's already listed as an overweight corridor, right?
I got you. Okay.
Right, so right now you wouldn't be able to restrict traffic until you get that worked out.
Until
we
get it cleared through the
right.
RMA.
Right. Road is in a state road, so I have no say in that. Right. Right.
Mm-hmm. And FAR has an ordinance too, as far as heavy trucks, so we can't go. I agree with you, you know, and I mean, that's something that should have been done here in-house, you know. You're right. I agree with you. You're right. Okay. Go ahead, sir. Yes. And then with
gradually reduce the speed limit when it's coming from 55 miles an hour to meet up that traffic who's going to be going into Stewart. Well, nothing happened. They just said that they wouldn't be looking into it with TxDOT. Nothing happened. So then came the traffic light, and again I suggested you have to gradually reduce the speed limit. That when it has been done, and there's several streets, like if you go to Dongo, there's a 55 miles an hour, but they have a big blinking light that it alerts you that there's a traffic light in front of you. There's an intersection. So something like that, when I did the research, several cities, that's something that could be introduced to our own roadway there for that specific section. Because, again, you're coming at 55 miles an hour, and you have that intersection. Not only does it mean that they have to brake and time more or less when the yellow light's going to turn and then red, but you also have to take into consideration if there's already traffic in front of those trucks, and you have that turn, the left turn there, both ways. Also, it's only a one-way route. So I suggested back then also as well, widening it up where there's in Stewart so that you could alleviate traffic and you have that much congestion. But you do see that in San Houston. You do see a three-lane in San Houston. But the other problem with that was with schools, and we're doing the comprehensive plan, and I'm meeting in that group for the advisory. We don't have something in place as to where we could designate land to use for schools. So as you know, Sorensen didn't exist back there in that location. There was only Austin. And the traffic was flowing good. We hardly saw any accidents. The other gap is that one, Sam Houston. We have two lanes going each way and three if you're turning left, but we don't have anything for Sam Houston. We only have a one-way route and no turn signal for left. So that's another bottleneck that you get. And that's where Commissioner Ramirez, I think, mentions the danger that exists there. Well, I did mention, if you remember, the crossing and the crosswalks regarding the schools where traffic spills out. So that creates that danger that you might be talking about, the trucks coming in through there. Well, we do have a speed limit of 35 for schools, but I don't know who installed that. It was the ISD or TxDOT, but it's only about approximately 20 feet from the intersection. That school speed limit should have been bumped back to the subdivision, because it's way too soon to reduce that speed limit from 55, and it's a 45, and right there is a 35. So speed limit, from my research that I did, does change the perception and the danger. It does slow it down, because like I said, that change should have been met first with the yield light and the opening of the bridge, and then the traffic light, and that does reduce the danger. And on the traffic, we can't really, I saw several alternatives. We actually have the fastest route to the expressway. We only have about three traffic lights and about two stop signs coming from the south. So as far as the noise, I did noise tests for several of the vicinities. TxDOT does have a 60-foot right-of-way, and then we have a 20-foot setback from the subdivisions on Stewart, and then we have a 25 average setback when you cross 83. So the noise, I did the test, is between 20 and 30. And that's a house with that set right away. Closed doors, closed windows. Open windows is 30 to 40 decibels. So the threshold of pain that someone might be uncomfortable, it's 90 decibels. And that would be standing outside next to the roadway about 10 feet. So that's never going to happen. That's no scenario that's possible. So houses are under planning and zoning code that they're supposed to be suitable, equipped for traffic, whether they have a buffer fence or a fence. So the scenario for noise or disturbance, the quality of life, is there's no merit that bears, because we do have a 60-foot right-of-way and 20-foot setback. So noise isn't an issue. I did those tests. But the one that worked the best that I saw was that the speed limit 55 and didn't have a big yield light so that the truckers and any other traffic can know that there's a traffic light up ahead. That does reduce and then widen up a little bit to work for that congestion, but those things do work. I've seen them in other cities, and I think that's probably the alternative that you guys might have, because TxDOT does own it on that street. So there's several projects that could be done with Stewart. That's some of the research that I did.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Appreciate it.
A lot of really good information. Thank you for that.
And so who does regulate the speed there? Do we set the speed limit, or do you?
No. Speed limit is not set by anybody. Like, you can't just go out to a road and say, I'm going to change that from 55 to
35. You can't reduce it.
you have to do a speed study. It's by law.
Okay.
That's the way it's done.
But who does that?
We do the speed study. Okay. Right. Now, just so that way you know, doing a speed study always doesn't reduce the speed limit, right? That's the risk when you have to do a speed study is if the traffic is going faster than it was than the posted speed, you have a chance of the speed increasing, right? So there's always that risk, but we would take care of the speed study, and we could do that also.
Take care of the study, but we can also enforce the speed.
That
by putting a patrolman there more constantly and giving citations and making sure that we're visible where the truck drivers, you know, can know, because it affects truck drivers more when you give them a speed ticket, especially in their insurance and their companies, and they'll be more aware that, you know. And also, I think so that we can install a radar like that pops up and tells you, hey, you're at 55 and it's at 30,
yes.
And that's going to open their eyes, like, you know. I know, because what you were telling us, for us to make a different route, it's going to take time. And hopefully, and I know that your plans at TxDOT with a loop is that in 7 years from now, eventually those trucks should be going through that loop, not coming through here. But in the meantime, we got to find a solution, and just for the safety, because we cannot move it to Cesar Chavez, because that's not equipped for heavy loads, and we have schools in that area too. Regardless of what, it will, you know, it's kids. Both areas are kids, and it will be dangerous, especially that's not equipped for heavy loads. So that means that any pothole or anything, those trucks can go either way,
right.
You know, so.
But I think you said one thing that is key is enforcement.
Yeah.
You know, if you're not enforcing the speed limits, if you're not enforcing trucks going too fast, you know, you're not going to do any good. They're going to continue to speed.
They're
going to
continue.
You know, and you bring up that on the speed limit, to have that speed, I think it's very effective. I live in the city of Far, and they put those in a lot of their speed limit, and it really does slow the traffic down, because you see, oh, I'm going, you know, 45 and it's supposed to be 30, and the police department in Far has been ticketing people, and so that gets everybody who lives there to slow down. So those are good, effective methods in getting traffic to slow down.
Would the speed study take into consideration the schools in the area, or it doesn't play a factor in your study?
No, I'm. That's where. It should.
When we did meet in the summer, the gentleman that we met, it was two or three, I don't know if you remember the names, Mr. Arjona, but they never even mentioned this that you mentioned today. Nothing that was mentioned by you was ever mentioned in that meeting. So,
Mr. Arjona,
they gave us the green light that day. They said, go ahead, we'll help you, help you with the signage and this and that. So, this is news to me.
On these streets listed here, I know some of these streets we paved, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay, can you identify which ones we did? I just want to make sure that I got this. It's Oblate, which is Oblate. We did parts of South Nebraska. That's TxDOT's role. But you guys recently did an overlay.
Section in San Antonio.
I know for sure Sergeant Leonel Trevino. Sioux Road was done by Precinct 2, if I'm not mistaken.
Mm-hmm.
Stewart Road is obviously those are pretty much the only ones, man.
Now, so what is the thickness of each road on
Two inch.
With a 6 inch leech in the bottom. And most of the heavy trucks will have 8 inch, minimum 8 inch with a 4 inch thick
top. Pretty close. You know, it might be a little different specs, but that's.
And the things that we asked Texas was additional lighting at that in that area, but we haven't gotten a response back. You know, flashing lights, beacons, you know, that there's a school zone and stuff like that, but we haven't gotten a response on that.
Approve a light, or, you know, but it's the either the district and a partnership between the district and the city,
right,
combine the costs, and one is because it's a benefit to the school to have a flashing light just for.
Well, they do have a flashing 35 mile per hour light now. The I guess additional, because you got a stoplight at Moore Road, right? So there's a stoplight there, then you got a stoplight there at Sam Houston. So in between that, the school is there. Before you get to Sam Houston, you got a 35 mile per hour school zone with flashing lights on it. Before before the right turn lane, there is a sign. I guess it's with the children crossing triangular sign. That one, I guess there's a possibility that you guys can put. Not the speed limit, but you can put the flashers on those to let them know ahead of that. That you know, you got a school zone, but I am going to bring up to our staff to see if we can move back the speed the 35 mile per hour speed limit back to before the where the right turn lane starts, right? So that way we can increase that distance. Now that right turn into the school, children don't walk through there. That that's for the buses to go in and drop off the kids, is from what my understanding is. I could be wrong. I don't know, but
In Austin Middle School, the 35 blinking light for the speed limit is too close to the entrance when the people are going in. Okay. I think moving it back will be better.
Okay, we'll look at those two options because I'm not. I need to talk to my director of traffic.
And the students, the only students that walk through that sidewalk on Stewart Road is the one coming across the railroad tracks.
Okay. But you still have a crossing guard there.
Yeah, we still have two. We have two crossing guards there at Business 83.
We have
pedestrians
crossing
at
any time during school hours.
Oh, yeah. You always have them 2 hours in the morning, two in the afternoon.
We still got, it takes only one accident.
Yeah, I know.
Anything else?
For the study, do we need to submit something in writing, or are you taking it with you already?
I'm taking notes out. What I'll do is tomorrow I'll meet with my director of traffic operations. I'll see him in the morning. We got some other meetings all day tomorrow. I'll discuss some of this stuff with them, and see what I can get back, and then I'll get a hold of Ben here, and I'll tell him what solutions or what we can implement, and to see if maybe we'll need to have another meeting or something, so that way we all can discuss it, or maybe the mayor and the city manager or whoever would. I'll go back and I'll talk to him about this about what we discussed today. And then I'll get back with you hopefully by hopefully next week or so.
Any other questions? Go ahead, Mr. Salinas.
To look at the right of way, what can fit in there, and then you got to remember that I think we only have 60 feet of right of way, which is not a lot. And we have I don't know what the width of the road is, but you have a 40 foot roadway and a 60 foot right of way. You don't have enough room to have a roadside ditch, and then all of a sudden your road's flooding, and there's a lot of issues that happen when you widen and don't have enough area for drainage. So we'd have to look at that a little closer.
And on that area, there's been some upgrades to the subdivisions in those areas, and there's been
some dedications.
Dedicated right away.
Okay, we can look at that.
So, because I know there's a big storm line that was just looked at in that area coming from Alamo, and I know there's dedicated easements and additional right aways for those areas there.
Okay.
Once you cross Sam Houston, it becomes a four lane or three lane? From Austin.
Two lane with attorney. It's a five lane.
You see, so that's part of the deal that, that bottleneck that he was talking about, that mm-hmm. you're coming in Stewart and it's just a one way lane each way. So what he's saying is that that will kind of open up a little more because it becomes a, once you cross Sam Houston, it's a lot easier because, you know, you have better.
And I, and the widening of the of that road would be good because, like, just before I got here, one of those commercial vehicles broke down. So it's halfway on the road, halfway off the road, and it's causing traffic problems there.
Now, just to be clear, widening the, like, let's say from Ridge all the way over here, more from that, that's not part of the plan of what we're doing in reconstruction right now. What we're doing is rehabbing the road. But stuff like that, it isn't budgeted for right now, so that would be something that we would have to look into getting funding to do that. I'm going to try to at least widen at the intersection of Ridge to try to get in. I don't know if there's a left turn lane right now into Ridge or that just doing a little widening, I don't think it will break the bank, but when you're having to do a big stretch, that's a lot of money, so we would have to look at
it. But when you widen to turn, it gives two or three cars a chance to move over.
Right, and get
because
through.
The trailers are trying to cross that green light before it turns, and you can tell that they're not at 35, they're heading 40, heading almost 50, you know,
they're
45, and that, because I've seen them, that they just, you know, and I see it on Carroll and Stewart, that the last time my light was green, and I hesitated like 2 seconds, always hesitated, and that rig just went like, It would have T-boned me, you know.
Yeah.
So because they're trying to rush that, that's why I say, hey, those speeding lights there or the policeman there, it's going to really bring their attention.
Yes.
Well, that's all I have.
Any other questions? Not. Is there a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Second.
Second.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
This meeting has been adjourned at 6:03. Yes, sir. Go ahead. Whatever.